Okay. Hello, everyone. Shalom. Welcome to class. Hope all of you had a good weekend, a good refreshing weekend. Got the needed rest. Yes, no. All of you had a good weekend? Jafina says yes. What about the others?
Yes, ma'am.
Sorry, Zenitoli, I couldn't hear you.
Yeah, good morning, Pastor. Yeah, I had a good weekend.
Good weekend, okay. Can you just speak something, Zenitoli, so I can just check my... Hello?
Hello.
Can you say hello again?
Hello.
Again,
hello,
please?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah, yes, this is fine. Yes, thank you. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, Zenitoli. Okay, let's begin the class. Can one of you please lead us in prayer, please? Anyone would like to lead us in prayer? Okay. Jafina, lead us in prayer. I have to. Yes.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you under the name of Jesus. We thank you for this day. We thank you for the class we are about to have. God, you're an awesome God. The gospel of you, the wisdom of you, and how you have created, how you have chosen us, called us, how you saved us. It's beyond imagination, Jesus God. As we are learning about you, help us to open our mind and heart and listen to the words so that we can live as your children down here on this earth. And we can proclaim this good news. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son for us with the great wisdom and knowledge. And be with us and guide us. Help us to have good Wi-Fi connection throughout the session. And I give all my classmates into your hands. Help us to understand the deepest truths of the Bible. Let your Holy Spirit guide us. We give you all the glory and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Jafina. Last week, the two classes that we had, we looked at the introduction to Paul's epistle to the church at Rome. And today we look at chapter 1. I hope you all had the time to read chapter 1. Did you all read chapter 1? Okay. If not, what we can do now is, we can quickly read it. So, can a couple of you read a few verses, please? And then we'll move on. Can we begin quickly so that we don't have, we don't waste any time? So can you please read at least 5 or 6 verses and then we can move on to another person? Romans chapter 1. Anyone would like to read Romans chapter 1? Verses 1 to 5.
Greetings.
Romans.
Yes, go ahead, Lubega. We'll have you read the first 6 verses and then we'll have Roslyn read the other 6 verses.
Greetings. Paul, a bond servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God, which he promised before through his prophets and the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who was born of the seed of David according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Through him, we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name, among whom you also are the called of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lubega. Even as we hear different people read, I just like you all to, just focus your thoughts on the reading, the verses, and we'll just share after this if something has just, some word just leapt out of scripture for us, we received some rhema word, some truths that, we heard in the past, but when reading, these verses today, you know, God brought it back to our memories, or you listen to some sermon, or you preach Romans chapter 1, and you can just share something that can encourage all of us. Okay, so we can keep that in the back of our minds even as we are reading. We'll move on, verses 6 to verse 12. So can I ask Roslyn to read, please?
Among whom you also are the called of Jesus Christ, to all who are in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Desire to visit Rome. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers, making request if by some means now at last I may find a way in the will of God to come to you. For I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift, so that you may be established. Still, which verse, ma'am?
To verse 12.
That is, that I may be encouraged together with you by the mutual faith, both of you and me. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Roslyn. So we'll stop here at 12, then maybe, you know, verse 12, and we'll, you know, have just time about to finish these verses, and we will read the verses 13 to maybe verse 32 on Friday when we look at it. So anything that really struck you, anything that really came alive to you from verses 1 to 12, something God touched your heart, something that was reiterated, some truth, something that just leapt out of scripture for you and you were reading, anything anyone likes to share? Yes. Can you hear Jeffina? Can you hear Jeffina speak?
It's echoing.
Oh, it's echoing.
Yeah. I hope it's fine now. I like verse 12. Where it says, that is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith, both of you and me. I remember reading this verse like maybe 2 years ago when I started reading the Bible. And I was really focusing on this verse for some time after reading, like how a faith of someone else can actually comfort us when we have the people who have faith around us. There is that's a different kind of vibe. That's a different kind of friendship. After reading this verse, I kind of left a lot of friendships behind, kind of chased after some friendships which can actually build my faith. And even until today's time, I still focus on being wise about whom I choose to be talk or whom I actually spend my time with, because I think that's very important. And even Paul, someone who is we think like who has great revelation, he says, I want to be comforted by your faith. So no matter of the revelation, no matter how much we know Christ, we all go through the times where we need that comfort. And as we are growing in faith, I think it's very important to have those people around us who can lift us up when we are down. So this is one of my favorite verses of all time. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Jeffina. Anyone else likes to share anything from verses 1 to verse 12 of Romans chapter 1?
Hello, ma'am. Good morning, ma'am.
Hi. Yes, Abu Bakr.
Yes. So I want to talk, just to comment on verse 2 and 3. So where it said, the Bible says that which he has promised afore by his prophet in the Holy Scriptures concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David. And my comment there is, Jesus fulfilled the Old Testament prophecy as a descendant of Jesus Christ, that we rule forever. So, and he called his name Messiah there. So that is my comment there. So you can see that the, all the things that that I've mentioned about Jesus Christ in the Old Testament was fulfilled from the Old Testament, and Apostle Paul make mention of it in that two verses, that it's going to be the descendant of David and he rule forever and is our Messiah. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing, Abu Bakr, and it's good to hear your voice again. Yes, anyone else likes to share?
I just want to read Romans chapter 1, verse 1. It says, Paul, a bond servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God. I mean, like, I'm just in awe how Paul, he's a mighty man of God, but he, the way he humbled himself and addressed to the people that he's a servant of God. And I'm just reminded that as a minister of God, it's more important than who we are in Christ, than our designation. Because what I notice in the ministry is that people run for the position, the name, but as a believer and a true servant of God, Paul is such a great, amazing example that we need to be humble and we need to serve God with all of our heart.
Yes, so true. Thank you, Zelotoli. Anyone else likes to share? Okay, if no one else wants to share, we'll thank you for those of you who shared. It's really uplifting, encouraging. Thank you. We study Romans chapter 1 in detail. Okay, so if you look at most of the New Testament letters, we see an opening introduction where we have from whom this letter is, and then who is it addressing to, or who is this letter being written to? So who is the audience that is being addressed to the letter? And then an introduction of the subject of the letter, or the reason for why this letter is being written. So we see this in almost every New Testament letter. There is an opening introduction, there is addressing the audience, and then an introduction of the subject of the letter, or the reason why the letter is being written. Now in verse 1, Paul says, Paul, a bondservant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated to the gospel of God. So look at how Paul is introducing himself. You know, most believers at the churches at Rome haven't met Paul, except for Aquila and Priscilla and maybe a few others, you know, but Paul introduces himself as a bond servant, and he is borrowing this from the Old Testament. What do we understand about bond servant from the Old Testament? A bond servant is someone who's subject to the master to whom they work for, and every seventh year, or the year of Jubilee, which is the 50th year, a bond servant was free to go. But if someone chooses to stay with their master, or they like their master very much, their master has been very nice to them, has treated them well, has taken care of their family, then the bond servant will make a choice to stay with their master for the rest of their life. It's their own choice. They willingly would like to stay with their master for the rest of their life and be a servant to their master for the rest of their life. Okay. So a bond servant willingly subjects himself to the master. He decides to stay with the master. And in that case, you know, they put a ring in the ear of that bond servant to show that, hey, this is a bond servant who for the rest of his life has chosen to live as a bond servant or a slave of his master. Or here is one who chooses to submit himself to his master for the rest of his life, and he chooses to take this mark of a bond servant in his life. Now, a bond servant is something that Paul chose, for himself. And he says that this is what I chose for myself, but there is also something that God has given to me. Okay, so he says God has called him to be an apostle. Yes, he chooses to be a bond servant, someone who's willingly made the choice to, you know, submit or surrender to Jesus's lordship for the rest of his life. That is something that he has made a personal choice. And then he says that, you know, there is something that God has also given me, and that is to be an apostle. Okay, so who is an apostle? What is the meaning of an apostle? What does an apostle mean? An apostle basically means someone who's sent out, a sent one. Okay, so Paul is saying that he has been sent to represent Christ. Paul is saying that Christ is sending me to represent his kingdom. Yes, thank you, Lubega. Sent one. Okay, so Paul is saying here that, he's separated to the gospel of God. Now, before I just continue, I like to just say that, you know, some of these things that I'm saying is not there in your notes, so you can follow through in your notes. And if you want to make your own notes, you are welcome to do so. Okay, and he says that he's been separated to the gospel of God. In Paul's writings, you will find these words, you know, which are very, very important. He says bond servant, he says he's being called, and he says he's being separated. So in most of Paul's writings, you will find these words, bond servant, being called, and being separated. So Paul really saw himself as someone who is separated, which means someone who's set aside for the gospel of God. The word separated, we must understand in the context of Paul. For Paul to be separated is a very, very big thing. Okay? He does not use these words very lightly or simply, but when he says separated, it means something very big or something very important for him. Because in the first 30 years of his life, you know, Paul was trained in Judaism. In Philippians chapter 3, he says, you know, I was a Pharisee of Pharisee, which means that, you know, he was the most eminent student of an upcoming Pharisee. And his whole life and his whole identity was in that fact that he was a Pharisee and that he was an eminent student of an upcoming Pharisee. And yet he says that he has given up all of this, and he's come out to proclaim a different message. And that was something really big, something that was really huge, something really important for him. So in Philippians chapter 3, he says, everything I gained, I consider it a loss. I consider it as rubbish for one reason, that I gain Christ. Okay. So the word separated for Paul was a very big thing. He says, I'm separated, I'm called out, I'm set aside for the gospel of God. Now, this phrase, gospel of God, look at how Paul refers to the gospel, how he shares about it in many different contexts in the book of Romans itself. In Romans chapter 1, verse 1, he says, the gospel of God. In chapter 15, verse 16, he also uses the same phrase, gospel of God. In Romans chapter 1, verse 9, he says, gospel of his son. In Romans chapter 1, verse 16, and chapter 15, verses 19 and 29, he says, gospel of Christ. In Romans chapter 2, verse 16, and Romans chapter 16, verse 25, he says, my gospel. So Paul refers to the gospel as my gospel, and he makes it very personal because he's received this message by direct revelation. And in Romans chapter 10, verse 15, he says this, he mentions the gospel as the gospel of peace. So the gospel, basically, we know is, what comes to your mind when you think of gospel? The good news, yes. You know, the good news, but Paul understands it in a very comprehensive way. In our minds, the gospel is what we share with sinners and, you know, with others as a way for them to receive salvation. But for Paul, it was the message. Okay, everything started here, or everything started in the gospel. It's the gospel or the message of God or the message of Jesus. And it's the gospel or message of what he is preaching. And it's the gospel or message that brings peace in the lives of people. So for Paul, he understands this word gospel in a very comprehensive way. For him, it is the message. Everything starts from here. It's the gospel or message of God. It's the gospel or message of Jesus. It's the gospel or message of what he is preaching. And it's a gospel or message that brings peace in the lives of people. Also, if you look at your notes, there are other titles connected to the gospel. We see the gospel of the kingdom in Matthew chapter 4, verse 23. We read about the gospel of Jesus Christ in Mark chapter 1, verse 1. Gospel of the grace of God in Acts chapter 20, verse 24. Gospel of the glory of Christ in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, and the gospel for the uncircumcised, or the gospel for the circumcised, which we read in Galatians chapter 2, verse 7. Now, what does Paul say about this gospel? He says it's the message for which he was separated, which he is preaching, which is the gospel of his son, his gospel. And he's preaching the gospel of peace, which was promised through the prophets. Okay, so he's saying, you know, when I just mentioned all of what the term that he uses of the gospel of God in Romans, just putting that all of together, he says, this gospel is the message for which he was separated, which he is preaching, which is the gospel of the Son of God. And this was a gospel that is given to him. So it is his gospel. He received that by revelation. And he's preaching the gospel of peace, which was promised through the prophets. Okay. So Romans chapter 1, verse 2, we see he says, which he promised before through his prophets in the holy scriptures. Okay. So he says, hey, this gospel was there in the Old Testament. It was proclaimed by the prophets in the Old Testament. And the message Paul is preaching is a message of the good news, which was promised through the prophets. It was already proclaimed through the prophets in the Old Testament. Okay. And notice how and what he mentions about the Old Testament scripture. He calls it as, how does he refer it to as? How does he refer to the Old Testament as? He refers it to as the Holy Scriptures. Okay. So by referring to the Old Testament as Holy Scriptures, we see that the regard that Paul has for the Old Testament scriptures. Okay. In the Old Testament, in the Old Testament, the prophets were promising the good news that was coming, and that is the coming of Jesus. And we see here in verse 2, Paul's understanding that the gospel we are preaching is not something new. It is something already spoken in the Old Testament. And we see Paul's heart for the Old Testament when he refers it to as the Holy Scriptures. Okay. In Romans chapter 1, verses 3 to 4, he goes on to say that concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who was born of the seed of David, according to the flesh, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. Okay. So the gospel is, Paul is saying, is about Jesus Christ. And in relation to Jesus Christ, Paul is mentioning two things here. In the natural, according to the flesh, Paul is saying that Jesus came as a descendant of David. Okay, so this was important because it was the fulfillment of all the Old Testament prophecies. The Old Testament prophecies were talking of the root of David, the offspring of David, And they were pointing to someone who would come in the line of David. And so Jesus is that, you know, he's saying, hey, Jesus is that offspring, the seed of David. Okay. But this was according to the flesh. But who is he truly? Who is this Jesus truly? He was the Son of God, or he is the Son of God. And how do we know that? Because he came with power in the spirit of holiness, and he was raised from the dead. So that's what he says in verse 4. He came with power according to the spirit of holiness, and he was raised from the dead. Okay. Now, who is the spirit of holiness? Who is referred to here as the spirit of holiness? Yes, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is referred here to as the spirit of holiness. Okay. So we need to think of the Holy Spirit as the spirit of holiness. Okay. So when we use the phrase Holy Spirit, sometimes we use the phrase Holy Spirit like someone's name. Okay. Holy Spirit is just another name that we commonly use, that we call anyone else we meet in our everyday lives. So the whole meaning of this name, Holy Spirit, is lost because we just use it as a common name, as we call anyone else's name. But for us, Holy Spirit can just mean, you know, can just be a name, but it's actually the Spirit. Or it can just mean that, you know, Holy Spirit for us means the Spirit of God, or one of the persons of the Trinity, or the Godhead, a title that comes very easily for us in our minds. But when we turn around and say the Spirit of Holiness, it actually, you know, it causes us to pause, you know. So when I talk of Holy Spirit, I'm not just talking about some person. I'm not just talking about the Spirit of God, not just talking about one person in the Trinity, the Godhead, but I'm actually, you know, talking of the Holy Spirit. I'm talking about him as a spirit of holiness, okay? Not only is he holy, but his presence is also holy, okay? Not only is he holy, but his presence is holiness. He's a spirit of holiness. So when we do church, you know, there is a sense of holiness, or sometimes there is no sense of holiness, or there is no sense of awe of God, because we speak so much of the Holy Spirit, we just welcome him in our midst. And sometimes we do it with the least sense of holiness. We just say, welcome, Holy Spirit, we welcome you in this place. We speak so much about the power of the Holy Spirit, the anointing of the Holy Spirit. But most often we do this with the least sense of holiness. You know, there needs to be a sense of consecration, a sense of holiness when we talk about the Holy Spirit, because we're saying, Spirit of Holiness, come. You know, even as we invite him, we need to be mindful that, you know, we are inviting the Holy Spirit, who is holy, we are welcoming his move into our midst. We're welcoming the Spirit of Holiness to move among us, and the Spirit of Holiness to work among us. So there should be a greater sense of reverence, a greater sense of awe, and a greater sense of consecration in our own lives and in our midst. Okay, now that was just a side thought about the Holy Spirit, but the main thought here is that Jesus Christ was proclaimed, announced, and revealed as the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of Holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Okay, so the two things here that we need to focus our thought on is that the Son of God with power, and the Son of God by the resurrection from the dead. Okay, so both of these actually point out that Jesus is the Son of God. Okay, so what are the two things that point out that Jesus is the Son of God? That he's a Son of God with power, and the Son of God by resurrection from the dead. Verse 5, through him we have received grace and apostleship for obedience to the faith among all nations for his name. So Paul is saying here, through Christ we have received grace and apostleship. Okay, A side note is, you know, there is grace and there is apostleship. Now, apostleship has to do with commission. Okay, it's the work or it's the mission that God gives us. And what is grace? Apostleship has to do with commission, has to do the work, the mission that God has given us. What is grace? Grace is free gift. What is grace? Anyone? Okay, the grace that God gives us to fulfill that commission, the work, the mission. Thank you, Jeffina. Anyone else? What is grace?
It's grace is undeserved favor.
1 minute, Paul. We'll hear Roslyn and then we'll hear you, Paul. Yes, go ahead, Roslyn.
Grace is unmerited favor which we receive from God to fulfill his call, his mission upon our life.
Okay, to fulfill the call and the mission that he has entrusted to us. Thank you, Roslyn. Yes, Paul?
Yeah, more or less the same. I was saying grace is undeserved favor.
Okay. Thank you, Paul. So here, grace is God's empowering over our life to do the commission or to fulfill the commission, the work, the mission that God has given to us. Okay, thank you, Abu Bakr. It's unmerited blessing, yes. So this is a common way Paul talks about his ministry. He says, through Christ, we have received grace and apostleship. Okay, so what is the commission we are given? We are given the commission to bring, according to this verse, what is the commission we are given? Each of us are given, what is the commission that we are given? Verse 5. To make disciples of all nations, okay? What is the commission we are given here according to verse 5?
So that it's written here so that we can make people obedient to the faith.
Yes, thank you. So here it says that, you know, we've given this commission to bring people in obedience to the faith in Jesus Christ in all the world. Okay. So the work we are doing or the work we have or the work we have from God, the grace we have from God is, you know, to make people come to and in obedience to the faith in Jesus Christ in all the world, okay? So the work that we are already doing, the work that we have, the work that was given to us from God, the grace that we have to do this work from God, what is that work? It is to make people come to and in obedience to the faith in Jesus Christ in all the world, okay? So Paul uses the phrase in obedience to the faith in other places as well. We see this phrase in Romans chapter 15, verse 18. He says, you know, Paul says, when he talks about making Gentiles obedient to the faith through signs, wonders, and miracles. He also talks about obedience to the faith in Romans chapter 16, verse 26, where he refers here to people coming to the obedience to the faith. Okay, so coming to the faith is coming to the place of obedience. Okay, obedience to the faith is not emphasized when we say, you know, come to faith in Jesus Christ and you will be saved from your sin, or come to faith in Jesus Christ and you will be blessed, or come to faith in Jesus Christ and you will be healed, or come to faith in Jesus Christ and you will be free. Now, obedience to faith is not emphasized when we say all of these lines, but Paul is looking at it as obedience to the faith. He's saying coming to obedience is when you come to a place of surrender. When you come to a place of surrender and submission, it is when we come to a place of giving up our own freedom, you know, to obey, are giving up our own freedom and come to a place where we come to a place where we are obeying Christ. This is something we need to make clear when we preach the gospel. Okay, when we come to the faith in Jesus, you're coming to a place of obedience to Christ. It is saying, Lord, no, I'm following you and you alone for the rest of my life. And, you know, that is what we are coming into. That is where we are coming to. And yes, there will be healing. There will be blessing. There will be forgiveness when we come to faith in Jesus Christ. But we are coming to faith is coming to obedience to Christ. Okay. So that is what I like to actually focus in on here. Is coming to faith is basically coming to faith in Jesus Christ. It's saying, God, I come to a place where I'm totally obedient to you, totally surrendering my life, submitting my the rest of my life to you alone. And when we come to that place, yes, you know, we come to a place where there is healing, there is blessing, there's forgiveness of sin, and there is freedom. Okay, so coming to faith is coming to obedience in Christ Jesus. Verse 6, among whom you also are called of Jesus Christ. So Paul is saying, believers, God has given us this call, he's given us this commission to preach his good news among all the nations, and you are also part of that, and you are also called of Jesus, and you've also been brought to a place of obedience to the faith. So that is what he's meaning when he's writing this in verse 6. Okay, so basically in verses 1 to 6, we see who Paul was. Paul says he's a bond servant of Jesus Christ. You know, he's called by God to be an apostle, and he's also called to be separated. What is he proclaiming? He's proclaiming a message that was already proclaimed by the prophets in the Old Testament, which is the Holy Scriptures, and it's a message about Jesus Christ, who was declared to be the Son of God with power and by the resurrection of the Holy Spirit. And Paul is saying that he is doing this by the grace and commission that God has given him. And what is his objective? His objective is what he mentions in verse 5, where he's saying his objective is to bring people in all the nations to be obedient to the faith. Okay, so that was verses 1 to 6. Anyone has any questions, any thoughts, anything that you'd like to share? Okay, if there are no questions and there's nothing that anyone wants to comment or say, we'll move on to verse 7. Can one of you please read verse 7, please? Anyone?
To all who are in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. Thank you, Roslyn. Now, Paul goes on to mention why he's writing to the Romans, or why he's writing to the church at Rome. It's always interesting in Paul's letter to see how he looks at the people of God. Okay, what is the view of the church or believers? Very interesting to see that in his letters. You know, how does he look at the people of God here? He calls them saints, and what else?
Beloved.
Yes, thank you, Roslyn. Thank you, Jeffina. As beloved of God, called to be saints. Okay, so as beloved of God, Paul is saying you are deeply loved by God, you are special to God, you are and he says you are also called to be holy ones. Okay, that is the way he looks at the church, or that is the way he looks at the people of God. Okay, so some of us, you know, who serve at church or minister at church, or you know, we are evangelists, pastors, you know, how do we perceive believers in the church? How do we see them? How do we speak of them? You know, we can learn here from Paul that he chooses to see them as beloved people, and also those who are called to be holy. So not just sorry, not just those of us who are pastors or those of us who are serving in church or ministers, but all of us, even as we are part of the church, you know, how do we look at people? How do we see fellow believers? You know, Paul, we can learn from him. He chooses to see, you know, believers in the churches as beloved people and those who are called to be holy. Okay. And then he says, grace and peace, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. It's like, you know, he's just giving them some good wishes, some well wishes. Okay. Verse 8. Can one of you please read verse 8, please? Anyone?
First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, that your faith is spoken of throughout the whole world.
Amen. Thank you. So Paul goes on to talk of how he prays for the believers at Rome. He says, first, he offers a prayer of thanksgiving. He's thankful. What is he thankful for? Their faith, yes, because their faith is spoken of throughout the whole world. And I mentioned in my class on Friday, why is he talking about the faith of the church at Rome? Yes, because, thank you, Jeffina, they were persecuted. And, in spite of their severe persecution that they were going through, they held on to their faith in Jesus Christ. And so Paul has heard and continues to hear of their faith in the midst of persecution. And he's thanking God for their strong faith that they have, even in the time of difficulties and tribulations and persecution. Okay. And what else did he thank God for? Okay. Look at verse 9. He says, for God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I make mention of you always in my prayers. Okay. And so Paul says, you know, I'm praying for you always. And he's saying, hey, this is not something that I'm just writing because I just want to make you feel happy, but I'm writing to you that I'm always praying for you, and God is my witness. Okay. And what I want to point out is verse 9. What I want to point out in verse 9 is the phrase, whom I serve with my spirit. Okay. Whom I serve with my spirit. Now, when we serve God, we think of serving God as a physical work, right? We think that, you know, hey, I'm going to preach here, so I have to dress like this, I have to behave like this, I have to do this, I have to act like this. And all of this is, yes, it's important, you know, the way we dress, the way we present ourselves, the way we act, the way we do things. All of this is important. But here Paul is, making a point here. He's saying we need to serve God with our spirit. Interesting, right? He's saying I'm not just serving God with my body. You know, first I am serving God with my spirit. Okay. So the question we need to ask ourselves is, what is the condition of my spirit man? Each of us need to ask that question for ourselves. What is the condition of my spirit man? You know, I'm called to serve God, I'm called to build his kingdom, you know, but what is the condition of my spirit? You know, serving God is a work of your spirit. The ministry work is spiritual work, which the spirit is, the Holy Spirit is doing in us. So it's important the Holy Spirit works in and through, you know, our spirit. We are building the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God, what dimension of the kingdom of God are we in now at present? You remember? Taught you about the kingdom of God. What dimension of the kingdom of God are we in presently? The kingdom of God, the two parts, the spiritual dimension and the natural dimension. So which dimension are we in presently? spiritual dimension, okay? Because the kingdom of God is where? The kingdom of God is in heaven? No. The kingdom of God has been inaugurated by Jesus here on the earth. The kingdom of God is in us. Okay, the kingdom of God is in us, and we are going to see the natural dimension of the kingdom of God when Jesus is going to come and personally rule the thousand-year millennium rule. But as of now, we are, in the spiritual dimension of the kingdom of God. So we are born again in our spirit man. The Spirit of God works in and through us, and in and through us, you know, the power of God is released and translated in and through us to minister to people outside in the natural realm, in the physical realm. So it's, serving God is a work of your spirit. The ministry work is a spiritual work, the Holy Spirit works in and through us, spirit man, and is released through us, out of us, to other people. So it's important that, you know, we keep our spirit man in good shape, and we keep our spirit man strong in the word, strong in worship, strong in prayer. Okay, so part of the spiritual work, he says, is I'm praying for those he wants to go and minister and serve. So Paul is saying part of the spiritual work that he's doing is that he's praying for those who he wants to go and minister to and serve. Okay, so another important thing that we can learn here today is, you know, though the work of the spirit is a physical, you know, we think of it as a physical work, it's more spiritual, because we're living in a spiritual dimension, the kingdom of God. The work of God is released in and through our spirit man. From here it's released out. So it's important that, you know, we keep our spirit man in good shape and strong. Okay, verse 10, he says, making request if by some means now at last I may find a way in the will of God to come to you. Okay, so he says, making request if by any means, the KJV version says, making request if by any means now at length I might have a prosperous journey by the will of God to come to you. Okay, so what part of what Paul is basically praying is he's saying that, hey, I want to come to you, I want to meet all of you, and I want to serve you. But even as he's praying, you know, here's what actually happened. Okay, we know that Paul was accused by the Jews in Jerusalem. We read about this in Acts chapter 22. He was apprehended by the Romans. And then he was sent to Caesarea, where he was escorted by 200 Roman soldiers, 70 horsemen, 200 spearmen. We read this in Acts chapter 23, verse 23. And then we see that Paul was held as a prisoner for 2 years in Caesarea. And from there, Paul appeals to Caesar. We read this in Acts chapter 25, verse 11 and 12. And then Paul was sent to Rome, which was a very rough journey. You know, they were stranded at sea for 14 days, ended up in a shipwreck, and landed at Malta. And we know that Paul got bit by a viper there, but he experienced no harm. We read this in Acts chapter 28, verses 1 to 6. And then after another 3 months of sailing, he finally arrived at Rome. We read this in Acts chapter 28, verse 14. But when he came to Rome, he was not a free man, like he was a prisoner. But a good thing was that he was not, he was under house arrest. So, you know, believers from Rome came and met him. Even before, you know, he actually reached home, reached Rome. We read this in Acts chapter 28, verse 15 and 16. And Paul spent 2 full years in Rome under house arrest. And, you know, even though he was not free to go around, but under house arrest gave him some kind of freedom to minister to all who came to him. We read this in Acts chapter 28, verse 30 and 31. And the believers were surely blessed, and the church was strengthened. So it was literally about 3 years after this letter was written that Paul actually went to Rome. But he went there as a prisoner after a very, very difficult journey. But Paul was able to spend 2 full years at Rome and impart into the life of the church at Rome. Okay, So just before we close, a lesson to learn for us here is sometimes, you know, the journey itself can be very difficult, can be very challenging, can be filled with hardships and turmoils. But for us, fulfilling the will of God, you know, that is a blessing. That is success. Success is not defined by the comfort or by the ease of the journey, but by fulfilling the purpose. Okay, for Paul, it was not at all easy. Okay, his journey was not comfortable, but he, you know, experienced success because he went to Rome and he was able to fulfill the purpose for which he went there. He was able to minister to people even as he was in under house arrest. So a beautiful thing that we can learn here is even as some of you are journeying in your Christian life, in your Christian walk, things can be challenging, things can be difficult, but, you know, stay on, because the success is not determined by the comfort of our journey, but by fulfilling the plan and purpose. And God will give us the grace and enable us, empower us, enable us and strengthen us, give us the favor we need to fulfill what he has called us to. Okay, we'll stop here. Anyone has any questions? We'll look at verses 11 onwards, the end of the chapter on Friday. Any questions? Okay, there are no questions. Thank you all for joining class. Have a blessed day and a blessed week ahead. And I will see you on Friday. Thank you, everyone.